physical aspect of the soul in the body is identified with the animal soul, which informs and vitalizes the form and constitutes its temporary life. During unconsciousness, the animal soul is aware of pain and suffering, and those who nurse and watch know this well, but there is no real pain or true distress, which is the real man. The spiritual soul has been driven away either by excessive pain, as in true unconsciousness, or by narcotics. The suffering of the soul, when the personality goes astray, is only a symbolic form of words. There is no pain or true suffering, and frequently no knowledge of the happening, for the vibration is not high enough to penetrate into that high plane where dwells the soul. Where, however, there is such knowledge, the soul experiences, if I might so express it, a sense of lost opportunity, and therefore a sense of frustration, but it is not more than that, for the patience of the soul, as of the hierarchy, is illimitable. Just because we speak symbolically and say the soul suffers, we must not interpret it in ordinary terms. The suffering of Christ or of the planetary logos or of God himself is not comprehensible in terms of personality reaction. We use the words that they really mean to cast an isolated identification. Does that convey odd to you, my brother? Wrong identification is the cause of pain and leads to suffering, distress and various effects. Right identification leads to understanding and comprehension of the psychological attitudes of the sufferer, but to no true pain or distress as we normally understand it. On planetary energy, the sum total of energy remains the same for as long as a planet persists, with its forms and life expression. It is part of the great storehouse of energy. It is a use in the effect of this energy, as it is appropriated by a form or forms at some time, which we know that it is attracted from its own place to a place where normally it would not be functioning. There it creates situations and produces difficulties which are closely connected with a man's karma and destiny. There is a great abstracting energy which we call death, whose influence at a given time proves more potent than the united influences of the body atoms and cells. It produces the tendency to withdraw and finally to abstract the soul energy which avails itself of these potencies in the Copyright 1998 Rules of Trust. 206. A Treatise on the Seven Rays. Volume 4, Esoteric Healing. Process of discarding a vehicle on some plane or another. It might be said that the seeds of death, the germ of death, are latent in the planet and in the form. When powerful enough to be recognized, we call them germ, but this connotes a definite stage of almost tangible proof. When unduly potent, they produce a deep disease and consequent death. When more feeble in effect, we call them illness and note their purificatory effect. These contaminations, as they can be called, though it is by no means a good name, are only being controlled by the mind from mental levels, then transmutation does take place. Transmutation whereby the astral nature is changed and altered, maybe of a spiritual nature or simply of an expedient nature. Desire may be transmuted into spiritual aspiration or into an attitude which is in conformity to the will of the mind which is expressing it. Hence the necessity for careful analysis of motive and of objectives. On karma. I have already suggested to you that the entire question of karma is as yet imperfectly comprehended. A great law of cause and effect exists, but one particular aspect of it has never been emphasized, and the knowledge of humanity on the subject of karma is very elementary. Karma has always been interpreted in terms of disaster, and consequences that are painful, of error, of penalty, and of evil happenings, both for the individual and for the group. Yet, such is the beauty of human nature, and much that is done is of such a fine quality and so selfless and so happily oriented, that the evil is frequently offset by the good. Whereas everywhere, little as it may be realized, an abundance of good karma of a potency under the same law equal to that which is regarded as bad. Of this, small mention is ever made. This good karma brings into activity forces which may work out as healing energies in any specific case. Upon these energies for good, which have been learned and are operating, the healer can always count. This is my first point. Ponder upon it. Copyright 1998 Ace of Trust. 207. A Treatise on the Seven Rays. Volume 4, Esoteric Healing. Karma is a determining factor, but unless a healer is an advanced initiate and so able to work effectively and intelligently on the causal levels whereon souls dwell, it is impossible for him to decide whether any specific case will yield to healing treatment or not. Therefore, the healer or practicing disciple assumes in his mind the possibility of cure, which may be possible or not, and of the patient's good karma, and proceeds to apply all possible aid. This is my second point. My third point is to suggest to you and to all engaged in the healing art that much of the so-called disaster, involved in disease and in death, particularly the latter, is to be found in a wrong attitude toward death, and to an overestimation of the beneficence of form life. The release of a soul through disease and death is not necessarily an unhappy occurrence. A new and better attitude to the phenomenon of death is essential, is possible and near. Upon this I need not here enlarge. But I do seek to give you a new slant on the subject of sickness and of death. Will you be astonished also if I state that under the law it is quite possible to interfere with karma? The great laws can be transcended and frequently have been in the past, and increasingly will be in the future. The law of gravitation is frequently offset and daily transcended when an aeroplane is in flight. The energy of faith can set in motion superior energies which can negate or retard disease. The whole subject of faith, and its vital significance and potency, is as little understood as is the law of karma. This is a tremendous subject, and I cannot further enlarge upon it. But I have said enough to offer you food for thought. As regards the lengthening of the span of life during the past century of scientific attainment, I would point out that true techniques and the possibilities of organized soul action are always parodied and falsely demonstrated on the physical plane by the earlier scientific activities which are right in motive but which are only a symbol, place a premium on suicide. But I do say, and I say with emphasis, that the law of karma is oft set aside when forms are preserved in coherent discretion which should be discarded, for they serve no useful purpose. This preservation is, in the majority of cases, enforced by the subject's group and not by the subject himself. Frequently an unconscious invalid, an old person whose response apparatus of contact and response is imperfect, or a baby who is non-normal. Please. Copyright 1998 Lucas Trust. 208. A Treatise on the Seven Rays. Volume 4. Esoteric Healing. Constitute definite instances of an offsetting of the law of karma. The soul, through alignment, enters into a right use of time, or rather the brain, which is the only time-conscious factor in man, is no longer the dominant attribute. The mind, as the agent of the soul whose consciousness is inclusive of the past, present, and the future, sees life and experience as it truly is. Death, therefore, is referred to as an episode, and is a transitional point in a vast series of transitions. When this attitude of the soul is grasped, our entire technique of living, and incidentally of dying, is utterly altered. In conclusion, however, and in appearance of no real negation of all that I have said above, let me repeat that the healer who gives his best to the one he seeks to heal. Having no clairvoyant power in the majority of cases, and being time-conscious and under the influence of karma, he will do his utmost along the lines of his own training and in accordance with the instructions given in this treatise on healing. I suggest that you grasp that the objective before any healer at this time and at this given point in the evolutionary unfoldment of the race of the need, went so apt, to aid in the bringing about of health to the body and its sustained experience in life. You need also to realize that much that is believed, accepted and taught by the metaphysical